From the far reaches of the Milky Way galaxy, it's Retro Nerd Girl with a film review for you. Today, I'll be reviewing the movie The Angry Red Planet, released in 1959, starring Gerald Moore, Nora Hayden, and Les Tremaine, directed by Ib Melchior. The genre is adventure sci-fi. The synopsis is a team of scientists and technicians make the first mission to Mars. However, they receive a very hostile welcome from the Martians. Enjoyment. You know, I have to really say that I like this film quite a bit. It had mixed reviews and was considered a bad effects movie even for its time. But among the cult B-movie classics, it's one of those perfect, it's so bad it's good movies with a mix of childlike imagination and terrible missteps. I just had so much fun watching this film. The pacing. At an hour and 23 minutes, it begins as one giant flashback and it drags before you realize what's happening. It kind of straightens out a bit by the middle of the story and gets really interesting by the end. The story. People who watch this film actually get hung up on how terribly wrong the science is. But the science we know now is not what people knew back in 1959. NASA had only been established in 1958, and I think that was late in 1958 at that. You know, then the world didn't know that much about science. The science that was taught in grade school was much different than what is taught now. We didn't know much about our neighboring planets. And, you know, space travel was a fantasy, so close to becoming reality. Before we knew that Mars was desolated and unsuitable for humans, interplanetary habitation was a dream and strictly left to the imagination. It's movies like these that inspired our predecessors to discover the truth, and so now we know. Sidney W. Pink wrote the screenplay at home on his kitchen table, recruiting his children to act as critics, and it shows because this movie would make sense to little children. It would terrify them, but it would make sense to them. Children are usually willing to suspend their disbelief for an interesting adventure in a make-believe world. Sidney's original draft was called The Planet Mars and included all sorts of strange creatures and an entire Martian city. The budget for this movie wouldn't allow this, so it had to be tamed to a shadow of his vision. The imagination here is good, but then the script fails to make this even remotely believable with a lack of research and a lot of filler dialogue. Though one thing it does seem to capture is the camaraderie between the crew of the ship. This team of explorers are very much friends and they get along well. You get that sense. The film is told entirely in flashbacks, which both creates a sense of mystery but also gives away the ending in the beginning, removing most of the tension. The challenge. The challenge in this film is actually the planet Mars. You know, the humans land on Mars and the first thing they do is freeze a plant creature, which in the film acknowledges that they are alive. So essentially, the Earthlings attack Martians as soon as they land, just recklessly traipsing around without consideration. And although the Earthlings think that they have come peacefully, they have no idea that they are committing offenses to the environment and invading it. In the case of our challengers, Mars, the Martians are actually the good guys. There is some empathy for the team of explorers. There is Dr. Iris Ryan, who is a brilliant authority in biology and zoology. She's not the average woman of her time, but she still suffers some sexism she herself seems to not be aware of. And it barely sets up the fact that she got there on her own or whether or not she got there because of her parents. mainly her famous father. Unfortunately, she is undermined by screaming and passing out quite often in the film. She's no Ellen Ripley, but she's the best precursor 1959 had to offer. The next person I'd like to talk about is Colonel Tom O'Banion. He is the pilot navigator on the ship. There is a budding romance between Iris and Tom, who doesn't respect her enough to even call her by her name and calls her Irish. There's lots of corny Casablanca-style lines between them. In fact, Tom kind of looks and acts and sounds like Humphrey Bogart. Professor Theodore Gattell, the authority on space and rocketry, who designed the ship, is as equally frail as Iris, almost always in distress. He's not exactly the smartest scientist there is, because what kind of scientist would light up a pipe in the cabin of a spaceship? The next person I'd like to talk about is the Chief Officer Sam Jacobs, the electronics and radar expert. He is the most likable of the bunch. He is the audience for the film, a childlike, fun kind of guy who likes comic books and guns. He's adorable. The technical aspects of this film. Director Ib Melchior was just given 9 days to shoot the film with a budget of less than $200,000. If you don't like the color red, you may not want to watch this film because there's a lot of red in it, and I'll tell you why. Besides the obvious reason that it's Mars, the process that was used for all the scenes on the surface of Mars was the result of an attempt by the producer, Norman Maurer, to blend live-action footage and hand-drawn backgrounds together. It sounds like a pretty fantastic idea. He called this process Cinemagic. Unfortunately, it didn't work how it was intended, and the footage was overexposed during the process. The director liked the effect and proceeded to use about $50,000, or just over a quarter of the film's budget, turning the footage into this Cinemagic film. I'm not exactly crazy about the visual effect, but I don't exactly hate it either, as some other people say they do. I think it's an interesting take because it does look otherworldly. I can totally imagine what the chemicals on another world would do to my vision, especially if I'm not wearing a visor. Yes, when leaving the ship, the crew's space helmets have a lack of protective glass. You know, visually, from a filmmaking standpoint, I understand why. The glare of a shield would prevent the audience from clearly seeing the faces of the crew. I thought that that was an interesting choice to sacrifice realism for aesthetic in this case. I suppose they thought that maybe the audience wouldn't notice, but many of them did. A lot of the spaceship technology was of the time, with lots of flips and switches, which looked a little rudimentary. Again, straight out of a child's imagination or a comic book. The most iconic feature of the film is the 40-foot rat spider monster, which actually is a marionette about 15 inches high, and a combination of a rat, a bat, a spider, and a crab. The monster was crude, but this creature was one of the scariest aliens before the xenomorphs in the movie Alien in 1979. Among the assets of the movie was a bounty of government stock footage. They tried to match it up, but unfortunately, it's comically obvious. And lastly, the end credit visuals were really awesome. I enjoyed it quite a bit. A kaleidoscope of jellies and possibly even jello, used to create a bit of eye candy for you as you watch the credits. The influences that you can see in pop culture from this movie. Invisible Invaders, released in 1959 as well, reused most of the musical score for this movie. There's also a scene where Sam is using his gun, but it's not working, and he says, I'm giving it all she's got. Hey, that sounds like something from Star Trek. Perhaps. And the famous rat spider monster is the same one that is featured on the cover of the album Walk Among Us, released in 1982 by the Misfits. The performances were really good. However, it is a time capsule of what was expected as good acting for 1959. The best part of this movie, the best part is the rat spider monster. You know, I bet it really scared a lot of kids back in 1959. That monster is pretty nasty looking. It doesn't look real, but if you're a kid, it would look kind of real to you. I also like the visuals of the Martian city and the landscapes of Mars. A great concept and truly, truly unique. My wish list. I wish that the cinematic effect would have worked. I'm not sure what the difference would have made, but it would have been nice to see the vision that the filmmakers were actually imagining. And I also wish that the hand-drawn plant life were actually real. Even the landscapes and the cities, all that. I just wish all those visuals had been actual props. They definitely had the budget for it, and it would have given the visuals some much needed dimension. I really liked the drawn ideas, but for a film, it just wasn't tangible enough to work. The ending was a little rushed, but definitely really good. I enjoyed it. It has an ominous message to Earth from Mars, warning mankind to stay away. And it definitely pays a little homage to the day the Earth stood still, when at the end of the film, Klaatu tells Earth that they should behave and not extend our violence outside of Earth. In summary, you know, I love this corny little movie. It's done in the classic 50s B-movie style, and it's that drive-in movie. It's supposed to be silly and fun, and you know, the science makes no sense and everything about it is dated, but I don't really care. It's a simple adventure with a childlike imagination, and I always have so much fun watching that. Well, that sums up my review. I hoped you liked it, and please be sure to subscribe to this channel. I'll be posting many more reviews. And let's keep this discussion going. Leave your rating for the movie and why in the comments section. Take care, movie lovers, and off to my next review!